السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله هيا للصلاة هيا للصلاة هيا للفلاح هيا للفلاح الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
الحمد لله لا أبغي به بدلا حمدا يبلغ من رضوانه الأملا ثم الصلاة على خير الورى وعلى ساداتنا آله وأصحابه الفضلا أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن سيدنا محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين وبعد فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله عز وجل وأحسن الهدي هدي سيدنا محمد عليه الصلاة والسلام وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار وما قل ودل خير مما كثر وألهى وقليل يغنيك خير من كثير يطغيك وإنما توعدون لآت وما أنتم بمعجزين وبعد فالحديث اليوم إن شاء الله عن الصفة التاسعة من صفات عباد الرحمن وهي مذكورة في نصف آية في خواتيم سورة الفرقان. Dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, today إن شاء الله we're talking about the ninth attribute of the attributes of Ibad al-Rahman, the worshippers of the Most Merciful subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in a half of an ayah, وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَشْهَدُونَ الزُّورِ. And if you look up the translation of this ayah, in most cases you will find, and they are those who do not testify to falsehood. They do not bear false witness. And actually is not the only opinion among the scholars what the word Az-Zur means. Let's go back to the Sahaba radhiyallahu anhum, Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas and Ikrimah al-Mujahid to see how the Sahaba understood the word Az-Zur. هناك كتاب للشيخ أبو بكر الجزائري أحد المدرسين في المسجد النبوي الشريف هذا الكتاب اسمه أيسر التفاسير لكلام العلي القدير يذكر فيه بعض آراء الصحابة والتابعين في كلمة الزور. There is a book of tafsir that is called أيسر التفاسير, the easiest interpretation of the Quran by Abu Bakr al-Jazairi. He is one of the Madani scholars, the teachers of the Masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Saudi Arabia. And actually, I had the honor one day to meet with him in Cairo, in Masjid Amr ibn al-As when he came to visit Cairo. He mentioned that Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas, when he described the word يشهدون الزور, he said, الزور هو أعياد المشركين. The feasts of non-Muslims. According to Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas, حبر الأمة وترجمان القرآن, it is الزور, that we do not, were not allowed to يشهدون. يشهدون means to attend. So the religious feasts of non-Muslims are haram for us to attend. But when it comes to some social celebrations, it's another issue to be discussed. So there is difference between religious feasts and social celebrations. We have to make this difference and to understand it. So this opinion always comes up here in Canada, can I attend non-Muslim feasts or not? Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu saw the problem very clearly. He said, Azur, which we are not allowed as Muslims to attend, on A'yad al-Mushrikeen. Second opinion, قال سيدنا عكرمة رضي الله عنه اللعب كان يطلق عليه قبل الإسلام في أيام الجاهلية زورا. اللعب, amusement and entertainment that takes you away from the remembering of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it used to be called in the pre-Islamic period as الزور. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks to the Arabs, He talks to them with the language that they actually understand. So they know that the word azul means amusement and entertainment. And that's what the Sahaba understood from the ayah. When we're allowed to entertain ourselves, actually we're allowed. But if it takes you away from the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, here is the azul, here is the haram stuff. I can play soccer, but actually it is the time for the prayer. If I don't leave the soccer and go pray on time, this is called zuhr. I spend the whole night playing video games and then I sleep late and didn't wake up for fajr. It is called zuhr al-la'ib because it takes you away from the remembering of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وقال سيدنا مجاهد, the third opinion. الزور هو الغناء, singing songs. And I've been asked this question many times. الغناء is halal or haram? Actually, I can't just say it is absolutely halal or absolutely haram. Because we have many, many things are combined in this word, الغناء. We shall talk about the music itself. It is halal or haram to listen to music. We should also discuss about the words that are being said in that song, lawful or unlawful words. We should talk about the voice of woman, is it awra or not? We should talk about the mixture between men and women, in which way actually they gather and mix, is it halal or haram? There are many, many things. The combination of everything, of all of them, is called ghina. So it's a big issue to be discussed. But if you look at ghina nowadays and the women are not properly covered and the words that are being said, I personally have never seen any scholar who said the ghina nowadays is halal. I have never seen this. Because it's very obvious what is being done is haram. It leads to a lot of corruption on earth. May Allah protect us, Ya Rabbil Alameen, and our youth. Now the fourth opinion, which is the most common opinion that everybody knows. The first opinion, shahadat al-zur, according to Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas, it is a'yad al-mushrikeen. According to Sayyidina Ikrima, it is al-la'ib, amusement, that takes you away from Allah. Number three, Sayyidina Mujahid, it is al-ghina. Number four is to give a false testimony, to lie. To give a false testimony. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentioned to us that giving false testimony, jihadat al-zur, is one of the signs of the last day. There is a hadith that is reported by Imam al-Bukhari عن سيدنا عمران بن حسين رضي الله عنه قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم خيركم قرني ثم الذين يلونهم ثم الذين يلونهم. The best of my ummah is my generation, the people who used to live with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Whenever they have any question, they have the source itself of guidance. They go ask him, and he gives the solutions. Sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then the people who comes after the followers of the Sahaba of Rasulullah, they used to ask the Sahaba. Then the third generation, Tabi' al-Tabi'in. Then Nabi alayhi salam started to describe the people who will come after those three generations. قال النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام ثم يأتي من بعدهم أناس يخونون ولا يؤتمنون صلى الله عليه وسلم. After those three generations, there will come some people who are dishonest. They are not trustworthy. They betray each other. You can't talk to him the whole night, al-ab'ad. And in the morning he betrays you. It is one of the signs of the hereafter. And actually, النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال أن أول ما يرفع من هذه الأمة الأمانة. The first thing that will be taken away from this nation is honesty. Is honesty. أن يوسل الأمر لغير أهله. May Allah protect us. Then he said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, number two, describing the people after those three generations. قال ويشهدون ولا يستشهدون. They will give testimony without being asked. And actually, we have this in our countries, back home sometimes. I will say in the courts, you will find a bunch of people who will come to you and ask you, do you need somebody to give testimony? I'm here, I can do it for you. For some worldly compensation, you give him some money. He sits down with you, you give him the information about your case in the court, and he goes give the testimony without knowing anything. This is what Nabi Asam described, يَشْهَدُونَ وَلَا يُسْتَشْهَدُونَ. They come to give testimony, and nobody asks them actually. But if they are given true testimony to protect somebody's life, it is one of the best good deeds in the sight of Allah. في صحيح مسلم يقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم خير الشهداء عند الله الذي يعطي الشهادة قبل أن يسألها. The best witnesses in the sight of Rabbil Alameen are those who give testimony without being asked. If he is God, protect somebody. If he is God, tell something that is true. But if they are going to give shahada to zur, it's one of the attributes of the people who will come before the last day. And then number three, قال النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام وينذرون ولا ينفون. And those people will vow, but actually they will not fulfill their vows. They will promise, they will give promises, but they will not fulfill their promises. Third one. They will vow like they will make nazir. Oh Allah, if you give me that job, I will do this for you. If you give my son that school, I will give that money in charity. And actually, it's not khayr. قال النبي عليه الصلاة النذر لا يأتي بخير وإنما يستخرج به من البخيل. This kind of ibadah, this kind of nadr, is not actually something beloved to Rabbil Alameen. It is something that Allah extracts or takes the money away from the greedy people to give it to the needy when they make nadr. Because they don't want to give it, Allah say, just Allah give me something, I will give you something in return. So that's why he said, يستخرج به من البخيل لكنه لا يأتي بخير. Number four, قال النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام ويظهر فيه مسلماً. And fatness will appear among them, صلى الله عليه وسلم, because of unhealthy food that sometimes we eat. That's why يظهر فيه مسلماً. في صحيح البخاري عن سيدنا أبي بكر رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم حذرنا من هذه الجريمة. قال كان جالس يوم مع الصحابة وقال ألا أنبئكم بأكبر الكبائر؟ ألا أنبئكم بأكبر الكبائر؟ ألا أنبئكم بأكبر الكبائر؟ He said that three times, صلى الله عليه وسلم. He was sitting down with the Sahaba and nobody asked him any question. But he wanted to tell them something important. So he asked them, should I not tell you about the greatest of the major sins, the sign of Allah? Should I not tell you about Akbar al-Kaba'ir? And he said the same question three times to let people pay attention. And they said, please tell us, Ya Rasulullah. Then he said, Al-Ishraq Billah, Shirk. Number two, وعقوق الوالدين, being undutiful towards your parents, not being kind towards one's parents, immediately comes after الإشراك بالله. Then كان متكئاً فجلس وقام. ألا وشهادة الزور؟ ألا وقول الزور؟ ألا وشهادة الزور؟ ألا قال الصحابة. فما زال النبي يكررها حتى قلنا ليته سكت صلى الله عليه وسلم. Then the Prophet ﷺ, he was laying down his pillow and then he sat down to let people pay attention. There is something very important is coming now after shirk billah, after rakutu with him. Then he said, beware of shahadat al-zur, beware of qawul al-zur, beware of Sahaba said he remained repeating the same warning until we said we wish that he kept silent. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They were very scared. Because you know what? You can destroy somebody's whole life just because of one lie. You can't give somebody a license which he doesn't deserve because of shahadat zur. You can put somebody in the jail because of shahadat zur, in the prison because of shahadat zur. You can't give somebody a certificate, any kind of paper, which he doesn't deserve because of shahadat al-zur. And of course, some of you have some cases in their mind that they have seen regarding some people who has done this kind of shahadat al-zur. And actually, we defend ourselves as Muslims. People shouldn't see Muslims as people who betray. As people who betray, we should be honest. Beware of shahadat al-zur. حتى قلنا ليته سكت. أيضا الله عز وجل لما ذكر شهادة الزور في القرآن قرنها بالشرك وذكرها مباشرة بعد الشرك. قال الله عز وجل فاجتنبوا الرجس من الأوثان واجتنبوا قول الزور حنفاء لله غير مشركين به. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, so avoid idolatry, worshipping idols, and avoid giving false testimony, shahadat al-zur. May Allah protect all of us, ya Rabbi al-alamin. Wa qul qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum. الحمد لله حمدا حمدا والشكر له شكرا شكرا. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. وبعد, last hadith إن شاء الله I will end up with. This hadith is in الصحيحين البخاري ومسلم. النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام, this hadith is talking about judging actually. He said إنكم تختصمون إلي وإنما أنا بشر. He said, I'm just a human being, just like you. إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ يُوحَى إِلَيْهِ. And some of you, they come to me to present their cases, their disputes. And I'm supposed to judge among them. قَلْ وَلَعَلَّ أَحَدُكُمْ أَنْ يَكُونَ أَلْحَنَ بِحُجَّتِهِ مِنْ بَعْضٍ. Here is the problem that the judges sometimes face in the courts. He says, Allah, some of you, perhaps, they are more eloquent than others. They can speak very well. They can convince the judge with whatever they want, even if it's not true. Some of you are more eloquent than others. They can give evidences. They can have some witnesses with them. قال النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام, وَإِنِّي أَقْضِي بَيْنَكُمْ عَلَى لَحْمٍ مَا أَسْمَعُ. And I only judge between you according to what I have heard, what I have from evidences. And then sometimes what we see in courts is, subhanAllah, that person is really innocent, he hasn't done anything, we know him very well, but the court has issued something against him. Against him, and he's innocent. That's because the judge, he just judges according to what he has of evidences and what has been said to him. قال النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام فإذا قضيت لأحدكم من مال أخيه بشيء فإنما هي قطعة من النار فليأخذها أو فليأخذها أو فليذرها. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم said, whomever I gave something which is undue, which he doesn't deserve, I give him something from his brother's rights, which he doesn't deserve, and he accepts this, it is actually a piece of fire, so let him take it or leave it. Let him take it or leave it. So even if the judge among you in the court or anywhere else, he judges between you and he gives a ruling that you know it is not your rights, you don't allow it to take it. As a Muslim, your obligation is to keep away from this. May Allah protect everybody, Ya Rabbil Alameen. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. اللهم اغفر ذنوبنا. اللهم اغفر ذنوبنا. واستر عيوبنا. وتول أمرنا. اللهم علمنا ما جهلنا. وانفعنا بما علمتنا. وزدنا يا ربنا علما. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من قول الزور وشهادة الزور. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من قول الزور وشهادة الزور. وصلي اللهم على نبينا محمد على آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. وأقم الصلاة.